Wells, it's great to have you on the Beyond Sunday podcast, man. You have not been on the podcast yet.
No, I haven't. Where have I been all
I know,
my life?
Right? Now is the time. So, man, you're here at the K-Lo Fan Awards, man. How's it feel to be here?
It's tonight? So cool. I genuinely love it. Getting to see all the different artists, many of whom I call friends, especially with this particular group of fans, so passionate about the music, so passionate about Jesus. And it's fun getting to hang out.
That's cool, man. So you've been on the road with Chris Tomlin a lot.
Yeah.
How's that been going?
Dude, awesome.
Yeah.
We did the Worship Night in America tour last spring. I did his Holy Roar tour this spring with Pat Barrett, and it was a blast. Getting out there with those guys is nothing but fun.
Yeah.
It's just a party.
Yeah, man. I want to go back in time a bit. When did music kind of start for you, like a passion for it? Was it when you were just out of the womb, man, you came out singing?
I think I loved music. You know, my dad is a musician.
Okay.
So great drummer, has keyboards in the house. There's a saxophone in the house, drums. We would have musicians over the house. So I was exposed to a lot of really great music. He has an incredible vinyl collection, stacks on stacks on stacks. So just I kind of inherited that. But I remember sitting in my dad's truck one day. We were listening to an album. He got out to pump gas, and a song was playing. And I said out loud, I love this. Like, I just loved it so much.
Do you know what it was?
Yeah, it was a funk group called DAG.
An
album called Righteous. Yes.
As soon as we get done with this, I'm looking that up. You have to go on YouTube.
I don't even think you can get it on iTunes. But there was a song called Mama's Eyes. And I was listening to that. I love this music. So from there, we started going to church when I was 10. Mm-hmm. And I realized an outlet for that love and passion and a direction to send it. And so I started writing songs and singing in church and never really looked back, honestly.
Yeah. Tauren, there's like people who sing, and then there's like Tauren Wells who sings.
That's hilarious.
You know what I'm saying?
Show.
How did you like learn how to sing?
Church, man.
Yeah?
I mean, church, I was not very good. You know, when I first got in the choir as a little kid, my choir director was like, Tauren, you need to sing softer. This is a choir. You need to blend. That's the point.
Yeah.
So I was taught by a wonderful worship pastor, and I was in a really cool church where they would let you participate. You know, a lot of churches, and I think this is good, operate with a level of excellence and a professionalism where a 10 or 11 year old isn't getting on the drums or whatever.
Yeah.
But I think it is a really special opportunity to be in a worship centric church culture that allows young people to get involved, and that was the church culture I grew up in. So I came to church with drumsticks in my back pocket, like hoping the drummer wouldn't show up or waiting at the altar for the drummer to get off the drum so we could take turns. So I grew up in that, and that facilitated that love. And then I've just tried to watch other great singers and learn and grow the best I can. I know that I have a long ways to go, too.
Oh, that's so cool, man. I love that because this is a podcast for worship pastors.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a lot of those young kids, those little Tauren Wells running around in the church, you know, like waiting to get on stage.
Oh, those poor people in that church. They have no clue what
they're
in for.
You know what I mean, though? There's an opportunity there for worship pastors to bring people under their wing and to let them flourish.
Yeah. You know? I mean, the classic Maxwell quote is, there is no success without a successor.
Mm.
So I think it's the role of pastors in particular to be looking for the next generation.
So good.
To pass the baton off to. And if we're not identifying people in the next generation, I think we're missing a great opportunity for us to pour out some of the things that we've received.
So good, man. What's a song that you've been a part of in your career that's surprised you the most?
I guess Hills and Valleys.
Yeah.
It wasn't my first single. It was my first single to go to AC radio. And my wife and I really believed in it as soon as I recorded it. My A&R really believed in it. But it took a while to get everyone else on board. Mm. And then my radio team at Provident fought for that song over the course of a year. and to see what God has done with it, it's gone gold. You know, amazing. It's amazing. But to hear the stories, it has literally been with people at the highest moments of their lives and the lowest. And I know those stories, and it's just beautiful. It blows me away.
Love it, man. Tauren, thanks for your time today, man. Thanks for what you're doing.
Yes, sir.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, man.